Welcome to From Credit to Virginia's virtual Meet the CEO live webinar event. I'm Katie Frazier, From Credit to Virginia's Chief Marketing and External Affairs Officer, and we're excited to have you join us today as we welcome our new CEO, Brad Cornelius, to the Farm Credit of Virginia's team. Typically, we would have loved to have welcomed you in person to an event like this. There's nothing more that we love than being able to get together and celebrate great beginnings like Brad coming to join us. I know that typically would we be joining you via for lunch or refreshments, and so hopefully you're being able to enjoy something like that in the comfort of your own home, preferably a farm produced product or two. And if you're not at home or in your office, then maybe you're out in your truck or tractor doing the good work that you all do. So we are excited to have you join us. So in addition to being joined by Brad today, we are also honored to be joined by Donna Brooke Ott, who is the chair of our board of directors at Farm Credit of Virginia's. Donna is the owner and operator and president of Brookdale Farms, a greenhouse, event, and agritainment operation in Mineral County, West Virginia. She also serves on the Mineral County FSA board, on the Potomac State College of Ag Advisory Committee, and is the treasurer of the Mineral County 4-H and FFA Livestock Association. She has been a member of the Farm Credit of Virginia's Board of Directors since 2003 and has served as chair of the board since 2018. And Donna, we welcome you today. We know you have a message on behalf of the board that you'd like to share with us, and we're excited to hear from you.
Well, thank you, Katie. Good afternoon to everybody. As Katie said, my name is Donna Brooke Ault, and I am the current chairman of the board of Farm Credit of Virginia's. And I'm really excited to be here with you today for our first virtual Meet the CEO webinar. So you have to go with the current environment that we're in, and we're going to make it work. We're going to get Brad to you in some way. So we'd like to welcome you today. And on behalf of the Farm Credit Board of the Directors, I want to thank you for joining us today. The message from the board is a solid one. We have a senior management team and a tactical team that is experienced and qualified, highly capable in their roles and as a team, bringing immense knowledge to their positions, and extremely motivated to have a farm credit lending institution that delivers on the needs and wants of its customer owners. Our staff is in its entirety is highly capable, highly qualified, and motivated employees. We have a CEO in place that has all of those qualities. He listens to us, the board of directors, to his team and entire staff, and he is willing to listen to you, our valued customers. Financially, we are very sound. We have a strong capital position, which allows us to return the maximum percentage of core net income back to our customers in the form of patronage. This past year, we were able to give back $30 million in patronage to our customers. During this stressful time in agriculture, the board feels the need to continue to pay back as much of our earnings as we possibly can. The board and senior management team just finished our planning session, probably one of the best planning sessions that I've been on since I joined the board. Our new CEO led his team to deliver a successful planning session, which covered hot button topics crucial to the success of Farm Credit of the Virginias, like risk appetite, human capital, capital itself, as well as customer experience. Risk appetite has always been an important topic to have a conversation about, and as a board, we want to be aware of all risks, monitoring and prioritizing those risks so that we're able to fulfill our mission. Human capital conversation provides that future look at our leadership bench and how we invest and grow our employees, allowing them to reach their full potential at Farm Credit of Virginia. At the board planning session, we also talked about finding those motivated people who want to be part of the Farm Credit family to serve our customers with the same passion for agriculture. And the capital level, this has been a topic for many years, a broad topic, and we were able to narrow that down a little bit at the planning session this year. What is the appropriate capital level to be able to satisfy our customers, to satisfy our mission, and provide the maximum amount of patronage back to our customers, yet keeping in mind the safety and soundness of our association? And finally, customer experience. It's so important to the board and the teams at Farm Credit of Virginia. We want to be a customer-centric association. We want to listen to and learn from you, our customers, as far as the needs and desires that you have, We want to enable our team to consistently deliver what you must have to run your operation successfully. One of the main jobs of our board is to hire a leader, a person that has a vision and strategic direction that will lead this organization to success, a CEO. Obviously, the board took that action this past July when we hired Brad Cornelius. Brad has been with Farm Credit of Virginia since June of 2019, but his ties with Farm Credit goes even deeper, over 20 years. So when selecting our new CEO, the board felt strongly that we needed somebody with a philosophy and strategic direction that aligned with the board and the customers. Brad Cornelius was selected from a large field of qualified candidates as the person which embodied the same philosophy and desires the same strategic direction. He brings a track record of proven leadership, background in agriculture, and complex credit analysis experience with him. We look forward to a brighter and more positive future for Farm Credit of Virginia with Brad leading the way. I want to thank you for joining us today and allowing me to give you a glimpse of the things the board's doing today. Thank you, Katie.
Donna, thank you very much both for joining us today and for your leadership and the service and leadership of the rest of the board of directors. It's easy to see where your passion your focus for Farm Credit of the Virginia serving both our employees, but our customers as customers, that really shines through, and we do appreciate you joining us today. Now I get to spend a little bit more time introducing Brad Cornelius. He obviously was recently appointed as our CEO, joined us effective July 15th in that role, but he brings a wealth of experience to the position with over 20 years of service and leadership within the farm credit system up and down the East Coast. He began his career as a loan officer in his hometown, which he'll tell you a little bit more about, I think, today, and worked his way up to a regional lending manager at Ag Georgia Farm Credit. He then left his home state of Georgia and became the chief credit officer at Ag Choice Farm Credit in Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania, and then went on to serve as CEO of Cape Fear Farm Credit in Fayetteville before joining Farm Credit of the Virginias in June of 2019 as our Chief Credit Officer. I'm going to turn it over to Brad to give you additional insight into his personal and professional background, the passion that he has for agriculture and for Farm Credit, and his vision for Farm Credit of the Virginias. I know he's anxious to share with you how we can all leverage the strength of our organization to better serve you, our customers, and we're looking forward to hearing from him. So Brad, the virtual floor is yours.
Thank you, Katie, and thank you, Donna. I appreciate those introductions and the kind words. I also appreciate everybody that has tuned in this afternoon. I'm looking forward to this. I want to share some remarks with you, but the best part of the session we did last night was the questions from the audience. So please, if you have a question, forward that to Katie so we can answer them at the end of my remarks. The COVID-19 pandemic has changed all our lives dramatically in just a few short months. One of the things it's done to my transition is it's really hindered my ability to get out and meet people because we need to be safe. So we've gotten creative with forums like this, and I give Katie and her team a great deal of credit for putting this together. Our IT folks have made the technology work, so thanks to them as well. But our goal is, as soon as we can define what new normal is, for me to get out and see you at customer events and industry events and on your farms as soon as safety permits that. So thanks for tuning into this, but there'll be better days ahead when we can all have more normal personal interactions. I'm really looking forward to that. Just an outline of my comments this afternoon. I want to introduce myself and talk about my family and my career and my background a little bit. I want to talk about my goals for Farm Credit of the Virginias. I want to share the customer service items we've been able to provide during the pandemic and remind you of those things. And I want to give just a brief financial update as I close. So jumping right into that, as Katie said, my hometown is Cartersville, Georgia, which when I was growing up was a very small town of about 10,000 people an hour north of Atlanta. Since Atlanta has done nothing but grow my whole life, nowadays it's an extreme suburb of Atlanta with all the resulting traffic and crowding that comes with that. But it was a great place to grow up, and I had a great childhood thanks to my parents. My father was a retail grocery store manager, an extreme extrovert. He really loved the people and knew everybody's name. He worked really hard to provide for us, and he taught me everything I know about being a father and a husband and an all-around good man. He also taught me how to be a leader as he led his team. My mother was a math teacher at the local high school. She was the geometry teacher at Cartersville High School for about 25 years, which meant that me and my two sisters all had to sit in her class. And the town was small enough that everybody recognized it was our mother going in, so that was an adventure. But my mother was a good math teacher. She was a great mother and taught me about compassion and about getting along with others and how to help raise my family. She had a thing as a math teacher. She taught people math by saying you have to talk to yourself to remind you of the steps you take. And I have used that in my career to help people with credit analysis. I find it to be very effective. And I think the people I've worked with would say that as well. I am some mix of the two. My personality, I enjoyed sales for the 18 and a half years I was a loan officer, and I like to get out and meet people now. That's part of being successful as a leader. But I also enjoy the analytical side of the business, and that's why I was able to rise through the credit ranks, because the numbers mean things to me, and I can talk about the numbers. So very fortunate to have the upbringing I did. They sent me off to the University of Georgia, and I graduated with a degree in ag economics. And I did that kind of accidentally. I stumbled into it, as many college students do, but I found I liked it and enjoyed it and fit in well. Eventually, I decided to get an MBA at Georgia State, and I specialized in finance to get further that analytical side. And then I found my way to Farm Credit. When I got there, I brought the priorities my family had taught me, and they haven't wavered over my 28-year career. They're my faith first, then my family, and then Farm Credit. I've also brought the values they taught me and my personal values. I'm all about integrity. I believe in collaboration. Stability is very important to me. My family was very stable. My father worked for the same company for 30 years. My mother taught at the same school system for 30 years. So I come from a stable place, and I want Farm Credit of Virginia to provide that stability both to our customers and to our employees. My parents also gave me a commitment to excellence, to try to get better every day and then try to help the people around you get better. And I think that will serve us well in the future here at FCV. My family, my wife Jennifer and I have been married for 24 years. She is a school librarian by training, and she's done that. She's been a museum librarian. She taught English a little bit here and there as well. But mostly she's been a stay-at-home mom since we left Georgia and didn't have parental support around, and my job, the travel requirements increased. She is definitely my better half, and all of the good things that my daughters are turning into, I give her credit for that. My oldest daughter, Emma, is a sophomore at the University of South Carolina, where she is majoring in accounting. She has been involved in JROTC in high school and is currently a part of the Army ROTC program at South Carolina, where she plans to be an Army officer and then later have a career in federal law enforcement. My younger daughter, Lonnie, is a senior at high school. She's involved in student government and the church youth group and swimming. She really enjoys swimming. She did synchronized swimming when we lived in Pennsylvania. She wants to be a nurse and is looking at nursing programs right now. And one of the places she has applied is George Mason here in Virginia. She's very social independent. Emma's like me, and Lonnie's like my wife, Jennifer, if you had to ask me who they compare to. I began my Farm Credit career in Cartersville, Georgia, not having a farm background. So one of the first things I learned, in addition to the technical parts of the job, is I picked up a lifelong appreciation for agriculture. I learned the contributions that farmers make to their communities beyond the food and the fiber they provide, and that's a big part of what Farm Credit supports. And then I learned the important role Farm Credit plays in boosting and sustaining agriculture all over the country. So I took those three things from my first couple of years and moved to a little town called Royston, and it was really small. It's about 2,000 people. On the South Carolina border in Northeast Georgia. I got a chance to manage and lead teams for the first time there. We were growing really fast. All of North Georgia agriculture is basically integrated broilers. There's a lot of poultry there. It's the leading poultry state. So I learned about the dynamics of managing and growing a loan portfolio for the first time. After I did that for a few years, I was very fortunate to be offered an opportunity to join the commercial and capital markets team at Ag Georgia. We would call that the agribusiness team here at Farm Credit of Virginia's, but it's basically dealing with the largest and most complex loans. That was a great experience to build my career. I met some great people. I got a chance to learn all about complex loan structures and about financial reporting. I learned how to be an informal leader because I was responsible for balances in branches where I didn't manage anybody. So I had to go in and work with people. I had a role as a loan approver and I got to mentor people, and that was a really good experience. Eventually at 45 years old, I was ready to be a senior leader. And the opportunity I found, as Katie told you, was at AgChoice Farm Credit in Pennsylvania. So after 45 years of Georgia, we packed up two kids, a dog and a cat, into a Honda CRV and drove north to see what that was about. And Jennifer said we were going to treat it as an adventure, and it was a fun adventure. We had a great time there. We made lifelong friends. My career prospered. The kids got an opportunity to see something else. I learned mainly at AgChoice, the thing I would say I learned the most was about change management, about leading large teams and changing practices and policies and procedures. I also learned that I could go to a completely new environment and contribute right away. And that is something I learned that I enjoyed. And then as a senior leader, I got to mentor young leaders and found that incredibly rewarding. After a few years as a CCO, I was ready to sit in the CEO chair if I could find an opportunity, and I found a good one at Cape Fear Farm Credit. I went down there for 3.5 years and built a senior leadership team for the first time. I got a chance to be the face of an organization for the first time in forums like this and in person, and I enjoyed that. But eventually, I felt called for a new challenge, and when the chief credit officer job here was open, I enjoyed that role. So I took that a year ago, and I'm very blessed and fortunate that the board has entrusted me to be your CEO. And I'm looking forward to that and looking forward to us working together to make it an even better association than we already are. You've heard all these stories. You know, Farm Credit has been a big part of my life, but it's also been a huge part of raising my family. I've taken Jennifer and the girls to Farm Credit events in 4 states, and we have got to know people, and my daughters have learned how to meet people. They've seen how our customers and employees interact and learned manners and respect from that, and I'm very happy to have done that for them. But the most rewarding part of my job has always been the people I interact with. As a lender, you do that, it's mainly customers, and you know, you learn about their operations, and I've seen things. The smallest loan I ever made was $1,500, and I was fortunate to take part in a $125 million transaction as a commercial loan officer. So I've done the full spectrum, and I've loved all the people that have allowed me to help them. As your career grows and you rise in management, you really spend more of your time with employees than customers, and that can be equally rewarding because young people have goals and they have dreams and they have skills and talents that you can help develop. And that's really what my main focus is now, is developing the people around me so they can help us grow the association. I'm looking to build a legacy. I want to be sure that I leave Farm Credit Virginia's in a better place than I found it. And I'm accomplish that by helping people. You know, that comes back to leadership, my leadership philosophy. Begins with that the quality of your leadership always determines the performance of your team. I think that an average leader with a great team is going to be outperformed by somebody with great leadership and an average team. How do you build your team? Well, I believe in the active management of staff, which means we need to develop and advance our coaching culture. Coaching culture means that we set expectations for our teammates, and then after they act, we follow up and say, okay, this is what you did really well. This is what you need to work on. Let me show you how you can help with that. And that leads to continuous improvement. I'm big on respect. I believe that respect is the foundation of everything we do. Donna mentioned being customer centric instead of customer focused. We're going to look at the customer experience and really get close to our customers in all our segments and learn how we can serve them better and what their pain points are and how to eliminate those. Everybody who's a CEO is, of course, growth oriented, and we have to do that here. Growing the association is an important priority for the board and therefore an important priority for all of us. I believe in being transparent, that people need to understand the why behind your decisions. And if you tell them that, they'll buy in and really help you accomplish great things. I believe in being collaborative, and I like to involve more people earlier in decisions whenever I can. I believe that rewards and recognitions programs for employees are really important. And lastly, you know, a leader really needs to call people to their higher purpose. Part of the reason the Farm Credit system as a whole and Farm Credit Virginia's in particular have been successful for more than a century is we've always hired people who loved agriculture and were committed to boosting agriculture and helping farmers. they're intrinsically motivated to do that. You don't pay them to do that. They were out looking for a career to be involved in agriculture. And we're going to continue to do that as part of our success. Moving to my goals and vision for Farm Credit of Virginia's, you know, we want to grow. What does growth look like? Well, first, we want to grow in the number of customer owners. It is a basic measure of our success to see how many people we're helping with their financial needs. So we want to boost the number of customers. We want to boost our loan volume. We're up over $1.8 billion. We want to be a $2 billion association. We want to boost our profitability, because when you grow your loan volume and profitability, you can afford better technology for your customers. Teams love to grow. Employees love the growth part. That growth creates the opportunity for careers to grow. And of course, the more money we can make, the more of our profits we can return to you, our customer owners, in the form of patronage. Biggest plan for growth is just to grow the skills and talents of our team. They're very talented. I've inherited a great team, but I can't take care of customers from my office in Stanton. I have to have a great team to do that, and we're going to grow their skills so they can serve you better year after year. We need to expand and fine-tune the products that we offer. The world's pace of change, everybody knows, is increasing. We have to keep up with that and stay ahead of where products and offers, products and services we need to offer you. Sorry. So, you know, a big priority remains, we got to develop deeper and more important customer relationships. We are a relationship lender. We will always be a relationship lender. People like to do business with people. So we need those people that are committed to ag. And we need to be sure they have the right relationship skills and that our policies and procedures allow to serve you the best they can. We want to continue to be active in our communities. We want to support industry events and youth livestock programs, every other agricultural program that we can find to support. We're going to live out our mission, which remains to be an engaged partner in our rural communities. And we're going to live out our vision, which remains to be agriculture and rural America's lender of choice. So how are we going to do all this? Well, it can't do it overnight, just like at your operations. It's a small process that begins day after day, one step after another. We're going to have to plant seeds. We're going to have to fertilize them. We're going to have to treat them, and eventually we'll harvest them. But year after year, season after season, improvement after improvement, we're going to get better and we're going to serve you better. Right now, we're going to focus on improving our customer experience and understanding what your needs are. We're committed to improving our technology and expanding the services we provide. We're open to new opportunities and resources that we can provide to you. And we're focused on training and developing our fantastic team of employees so that you, our customer owners, benefit from that. So I've said a lot of things already. I should probably stop and go back. I am taking over in the middle of a global pandemic, which I hope will be a once in a century event. And not a once in a lifetime event, but we're not through with that yet. Everything has changed, how we go to work, how we go to school, how we go to church, how we can operate our businesses. But Farm Credit was established to be a stable source of credit for agriculture in good times and bad. We're gonna be here when corn goes back to $8, and we're gonna be with you through the pandemic. That is my pledge to you. That is our board's commitment to you. So how are we going to do that? Well, just a reminder of some of the things that we've done in the pandemic. We created a loan deferment program where almost every customer we had is eligible for 6 months of payment deferral. That program is still open. So if any of you are on the fence, if you're going to need that, talk to your loan officer. I don't think that program is going to close anytime soon, but it is still available and we are still promoting that. We did become an SBA PPP lender to help people with that program, and we were able to help almost 60 of our customers with that. Our staff is now helping those 50 some odd customers go through the loan forgiveness portion of the program. We continue to operate our branches through the pandemic, and I tip my hat to our staff that works in the branches. Those customer service representatives and loan officers and branch managers have been there every day through the pandemic, through the information that we get every day, and some of it's scarier than others, but they came in and they did their jobs to serve you, and I give them a lot of credit, and I give them my eternal thanks for doing that. We also, through the pandemic, have provided a pandemic website and a number of emails to keep you informed, and the Knowledge Center has expanded their programs to give more webinars to give people more information to help them weather the pandemic. So going forward, what are we going to do? Well, we're going to continue to be responsive to your needs as you look for customized solutions to weather these times. As public safety has allowed, we've reopened our branches by appointment recently, and we can meet with you there, or also we can meet with you at your place of business or on your farm. We're going to follow safety protocols through that, and I know our customers understand that we have to protect them and protect our staff by following those protocols. Our team members are spending time staying up to date on federal and state programs of assistance that can help you with this, and we're going to keep you informed of those additional resources. And we're continuing our commitment to participate in our industry events, youth livestock shows and sales, and the educational offerings. Matter of fact, in just a few weeks, we're going to start a new program, which will be the formal announcement later this month. We're going to aim that at providing mental health and work-life services to you, our customer owners, free of charge to help you get through these times. Donna mentioned patronage. You know, we're on track to pay a good level of patronage again this year, and that's a big part of the service we provide. Donna mentioned the annual business planning session, which I thought was great, and we really did a lot of good things there. Take a minute here just to praise our board. Our board, a lot of people don't understand the time commitment it takes to serve on Farm Credit Board. There are the board meetings you have to go to and the other events, but there's also training they undergo every year. And we're very thankful that we have people of that quality dedicated to your association to do that. That said, it is election season. You'll be getting a ballot in the mail before too long, and I would urge you to vote for the candidates of your choice. We appreciate you taking part in your co-op, and the more people who vote, the more voices will be heard. I want to close with a quick financial update. We continue to be in a strong financial condition, as Donna said. Our capital ratio is about 23%, which is very strong. Our loan portfolio has grown to more than $1.8 billion, which is about 1% growth this year, which is about what we forecast before the pandemic. So we're very pleased that we've been able to grow through the pandemic. Net income for the first 7 months was $17.5 million. Which is slightly ahead of our projections, even with all the COVID-related changes and expenses. And credit quality remains good. Fully acceptable credit's about 92.3%, and non-accruals are $27.4 million, which is about 1.5% of the portfolio, which is a very manageable level, given the times that we've been in and the stress in the economy. Katie told me I should close with a good story, so I've got my farm credit story, and this is the best one I got, so I'm going to lead with it. My grandfather, Blake Rutland, raised 11 kids on the family farm in North Bartow County there near Cartersville. My grandfather, Rutland, was one of those people, and he passed away when I was very small, so I have no real memory of him, but, you know, the stories he told my mother affected my upbringing. He talked about that his family had borrowed some money and had really had to fight through their depression to pay it back. They were worried about losing the farm because everybody was broke in the Great Depression in rural Georgia. And then when I was a senior in college, the Rutland family property wasn't sold when my great-grandparents died. The kids chose to keep it, and they sold some when I was a senior, and my mother got a check for her share, and that really paid for my last year of college. So I got a direct benefit from the Rutland farm. I started working for Farm Credit, so I was at the courthouse to look at deed records, and I looked up the Rutland family farm. Lo and behold, Blake Rutland borrowed $1,500 from the Federal Land Bank of Columbia, which is what Farm Credit operated as back then, in 1932, and had to make monthly payments of $31 or $32 for whatever time period that was. So what that means to me is that somebody at Farm Credit worked with my family, my predecessors, through the Great Depression and allowed them to keep that property. And that property later benefited my family in helping me pay through college. That means that the work we do with Farm Credit doesn't end today when we close a loan, that everybody we help stay on the farm, their family is gonna benefit for a couple of generations. And I feel really good about the good Farm Credit does when I hear stories like that. It also personally allows me to say that my personal Farm Credit story begins in 1932, so I've enjoyed. Anyway, that is the end of my prepared remarks, and I know Katie has probably a list of your questions, so I will turn it back over to her and see what questions you have for me.
Brad, thank you for your comments. Thank you for your passion. I think having a family history with Farm Credit for close to 100 years really probably influences everything that you do for us with your leadership style and your passion for not only making us continue to serve our customers, but making us better at how we do that. And so really, I'm excited to be able to work with you, and I know the rest of our team and our board is as well. So going to start off with a question for Brad as a CEO and a long-term employee of Farm Credit, and Donna, both as a director and customer. And that is, what's your favorite thing about working for Farm Credit? Brad, we'll let you go first, and then Donna, you can follow.
You know, my favorite thing is the people we get to interact with. Sometimes you're helping people with really big long loans and major purchases, and sometimes you're financing a tractor for a young family that has a few acres they want to mow the hay on. But just the excitement they have in living out their dream, whether it's a really big dream or a relatively small one, really gives me energy, and knowing the good that we do, that's the primary motivator for my Farm Credit career.
That was a good answer, Brad, and I would steal it if I could. But I, too, have excited about over the years that I've served in Farm Credit, meeting all of the customers, getting to know fellow farmers that I'm close to, that I live close to and work close to, but also those across our territory. I've gotten to meet a lot of customer borrowers that, their stories stick in your mind, and it makes you want to do the best job you can as a director on this board. Also, one of my favorite things about working with Farm Credit is going into D.C. and telling our story to the legislative people down there. There's so few that are actually, familiar with agriculture out there, and yet they make the rules and the laws that we have to abide by. So going in and telling our story, making sure that we tell all of our customers' story, the whole agricultural story down there, is so important, and I enjoy doing that.
Thank you both, and I will say you are speaking words that warm my heart when you express the importance of advocacy for agriculture and for Farm Credit, and our folks that are on the line can go on to our website and check out our leader articles to find out more about how you can add your voice to the Farm Credit Future Action Alert System. Just a little plug there from your friendly external affairs officer. So, Brad, you have had a long tenured career with Farm Credit. What are some of the major changes you've seen in agricultural lending through that time?
You know, the biggest change that I've seen is technology. When I came to work, we had the Ag First District had an email system, but it was a private system that only went to people that worked for the 19 associations in the district, and it was a black screen with the yellow letters on it, and you had an 8286 or something processor that, you know, is about a tenth as good as the one people carry around their phones now. But with the technology change, the speed expectation changed. You know, there was a time when I needed a loan approved, I had to put the file in a car and drive across North Georgia to go to an office to get a certain level of loan approval. The technology has allowed us, with electronic files, we just email it through secure email now, and the approver gets it in literally no time. But as the technology has sped up, our customers' expectations of how quickly we can act has sped up. And we have to continue to stay on top of that, because the world's not going to slow down. And every time that Amazon can deliver a product in 24 hours, or Domino's can tell you where your pizza is through the whole process, our customers are learning that they need to know more, and we need to be responsive to that.
So a follow-up question to changes for both of you. When you look ahead to the future of Farm Credit and to agriculture, what challenges and opportunities do you both see that are in our future?
You know, I think one of the challenges for agriculture is demographic, and it's a Farm Credit challenge too, that farm operations statistically are getting larger, which means that they're consolidating, that there are fewer large farms for us to finance. So if we miss a customer, we miss a larger customer, and that stays at another lending institution. And then there's a lot of small farmers. A lot of people dabble in agriculture. It's not their primary source of income, but they do it for the income, for the experience for their children, or just because they enjoy it. So we have to adapt our systems to deal with those big farmers and deal with the small farmers. But related to that, I know Donna mentioned going to Washington. Well, we say that 2% of Americans are farmers, but 2% of Americans aren't commercial farmers that produce the feed and fiber. The number is a good bit smaller than that. And as it consolidates, it's going to get more. And we have to tell our story over and over, and we have to tell it very well for people to understand the importance of agriculture when you have so many people in Congress that, you know, I'm the great grandparent generation away from the farm. My kids are great great, and there's a lot of people that are going to be in Washington working in those congressional offices over the next 5 years that are going to be my kids' age. And that's really how you get to the Congress people, the members of Congress, is to go through their staff.
Yeah, so when I hear the word challenges, I think of opportunities, as you said, and I think it's exciting when you go through a challenging time to see what you can, you know, create out of that challenging time, what farm credit can become, what agriculture can become. And on my farm, I'm a traditional dairy farm, and so for years it was a roller coaster ride, and we used to call it bill lottery, how you could pay the bills. And so we did diversify, and I think it's going to be exciting to see what agriculture diversifies into, to be able to save the farm, or to be able to expand the farm, or to be able to serve the customers out there, the community out there, what they're wanting. So I think challenges create opportunities, and I'm excited to see what kind of opportunities we all come up with.
It dawns on me nodding my head back and forth. Thank you both for those great answers. I think as we look at those challenges and opportunities, there's a bright future for all of us. As we look to the future, there's obviously folks who are interested in urban agriculture and urban farming and diversified agriculture. Do you envision Farm Credit of the Virginias expanding our efforts in those two marketplaces as folks look to address inequalities and issues with food delivery and food access, and the growing interest of agriculture expands to not only rural areas, but also our suburban and urban areas?
You know, Katie, I certainly do. We are created to serve agriculture, and agriculture looks different now than it did in 1916, and we've been able to adapt to that. But I think those of us that have larger cities where there's possibility of urban agriculture, I guess you could have it in smaller cities, but what I've seen mainly occurs in the larger metropolitan areas. With that going on in our territory, we need to understand what that is, and we need to offer our services. We're always bound by the Farm Credit Administration's eligibility rules. But that should not. I know of other farm credits that are doing some financing for urban agriculture, and I would expect when the opportunity arises that Farm Credit Virginias will be very happy to participate in that.
And I would agree with Brad as far as the board. The board will be and desire for us to be there for any urban farmers that would require lending needs. So and. You know, in my part with the diversified agriculture that we become, we're no longer just a traditional dairy, but we do agritainment. So we became agritainment when agritainment was never even heard of. It wasn't cool yet. So this will be our 19th year for a corn maze. We've been a greenhouse for 16 years, and we 6 years ago we put up a an event building, which, you know, Farm Credit is our lender. We went to other banks, and they had been after me for years to become a borrower of theirs. When I did need them, I went to them to check them out, and, you know, they said no thank you, but Farm Credit was there for me and was able to lend me the money to do the diversification that we needed to be able to save the traditional dairy farm. So I think we'll be there for urban farmers as well as the traditional farmers that we have here in the farming areas.
Building off of that, what, when you think about Farm Credit of the Virginias specifically, what are you most proud of for FCV?
You know, the thing I'm most proud of is the service we provide to people, that we live out that mission, and we live out that vision, and we provide, we're the lender of choice in our territory. I couldn't be proud of that without being tremendously proud of the people that provide that service. We have 185-ish employees, and all of those people are dedicated to serving you, our customer owners. And all of the success we have and all the success we have had comes from those individual employees' effort, serving one customer at a time at the various locations scattered across our territory.
Yeah, I'm excited and proud right now of the team that we have, the future that we have, the board that we have. I've gotten to work with this board since 2003, and our passion for agriculture and for this association wanting to see it succeed and become even more successful is exciting to me.
So it wouldn't be 2020 if we didn't talk about COVID and the elephant that it is in every room. So Brad, you outlined in a great way. We're going to have to steal some of those talking points for future communications, some of the changes that Farm Credit of the Virginias has made to accommodate COVID. Do you see any of those changes impacting our operations and the way that we serve our customers in the long term?
You know, that's a great question, Katie. I think the thing that we know will be permanent for Farm Credit of the Virginias is we sent people to work from home in a two-week stretch in March. We sent people we never thought we could send home. We allowed a lot of job functions and a lot of people just, you know, here's a laptop. These are your security protocols as a reminder. Please go do your job from home. And our people could not have responded better. Our managers could not have led better. We did things I wasn't sure we could do. But before that, we had certain numbers of people working home, and we had some people, it was usually by job role. Some job roles we were more willing to do that than others. Now that they've proven they can do that for months and months, I'm sure that we'll have a more wide open work from home stance going forward whenever the pandemic ends. It won't be for everybody, and it may not be 5 days a week at home, but I know it's a competitive advantage in the market to let people work from home or to have the flexibility they need, because the modern world is busy and family structures are different, schooling is different. So I know we'll have an expanded work from home stance after the pandemic. I can't tell you today exactly what that looks like, but that would be one change for sure I know would be there. All of the others, I think events will influence that, and the length of the pandemic and what we learn going through the pandemic will kind of influence those.
So a question I'm sure on most folks' mind when you mentioned patronage, both of you spoke about that. So any predictions on if COVID will impact patronage in the near or long term as we look to return that to our customer owners?
You know, patronage is always a board decision, but I've been around a long time, and I know the board's thinking as well as the financial metrics behind it. In the short run, our net income is actually above plan by a small amount. If our net income is the same, patronage will probably be in the same range it has been, up to the board's decision. The only reason that would change in the longer run is if we have significant expenses or if we have significant loan losses related to the pandemic that we might need to adjust. We are very well capitalized at 23%. We have some $430 million worth of capital. So we're strong enough to withstand pretty much whatever COVID brings. And I hope that the relatively small effects to our credit quality and our income that have been so far continue for all our customers. But I know that's not the case for many of our customers. So we're on track for patronage this year. I'll tell you in a year what it looks like next year.
Yes, and Katie, voice from the board, we are committed as the board of Farm Credit of the Virginias to provide that patronage that our customers so deeply need right now and expect. So as Brad said, we are well capitalized and we're on track for this coming year. So after that, We'll see what happens. But yes, the board is committed to providing the patronage the customers expect.
I'll just put a plug in there for our marketing and communications folks that once you receive your patronage check, be sure to take a patronage selfie and share it with us. We'd love to be able to celebrate with you as our cooperative gives back to you, our customer owners. So just a friendly reminder on that as we get to patronage season next year. Brad, you mentioned customer appreciation events. Typically, you know, we would use those type of events or others to introduce you to our teams and our customers. We would have board members like Donna and others who would be there, as well as our employees. Any prospects on FCV holding those in 2020 and other opportunities that we may have to interact with our customers moving forward?
You know, I'm going to let Katie correct me since her department handles these things if I misspeak, but I think I can speak. We have canceled customer appreciation events for 2020. We usually have those in the summer, and the summer is rapidly winding down anyway. But it wasn't safe, and it wouldn't have been permitted in some instances for us to do that. So we have canceled customer appreciation events. We'll look at those for next year as the time gets closer. In between, as the governor eases and we think it's safe, we may have some other kinds of events because our staff wants to be out and see you as much as I want to get out and meet you. So stay tuned for further developments as the pandemic posture eases in our states.
So I'm going to ask you to put on maybe a, I don't know, say a fortune teller's hat, but a futurist hat a little bit. Any predictions, insights on what interest rates are going to do in the future, and where are they right now?
Well, I always told my customers when they asked me as a loan officer what interest rates were going to do, if I could predict interest rates, I'd be working in Chicago for about 2 weeks, and then I would be retired somewhere. So not having that ability to see in the future, I can say that the Fed guidance is that they believe inflation has been tamed and that rates will not be rising very much in the foreseeable future. That would be consistent with the other things I've read. So we do not, as an association, we're not predicting a rapid rise in rates anytime soon or a large rise in rates, even if it's not rapid. So the Fed is signaling that interest rates are going to be stable, and I hope that they're correct.
Well, Brad, I'll say that if you start to get accurate predictions on interest rates, you know, feel free to give me a call or two. I have at least one kiddo to send through college at some point in time, so I could use some good tips there. So probably time for two, maybe three other questions. We chatted a good bit about technology. How that's changed over the years. You know, we're pivoting now and delivering virtual webinars and Meet the CEO events to our customers. So what are some of the technology improvements that Farm Credit of the Virginias is looking to implement in the future?
You know, the things that the customers would see most, we are the Ag First District where we buy our technology. We are able to buy technology using the whole district's buying power of $25-30 billion rather than our own is 1.8 through our Ag First partnership. But they are experimenting with and piloting an online loan application, which I know a lot of our customers would like to have. And that is coming if things go according to plan in the months ahead. There's some things that are, you know, kind of in the back office that are important to us that we're working on that will make us more efficient. We are talking about replacing our legacy accounting systems. We actually have three, and that's at least one too many. And the systems we have were in place when I came to work in 1992, so they're antiquated. Having a new accounting system would make the people that do our accounting in the branches and punch payments and things would make their lives a lot easier. And I think it would automate some things and enable us to both make our employees happier and be more efficient. And then AgFirst is also piloting a project to replace our loan origination software. We did that a few years ago, and it's not the product we really need district-wide. Customers won't see that, but if we can pick up some speed if we can get you an answer faster, if we can be more efficient so we can pay you more patronage, you can feel the effects of that.
I know we're all looking forward to seeing those improvements in the future. So competition is the name of the game. And Brad, as you outlined, our vision, mission, we want to be our communities and agriculture's lender of choice. So what are some of the things we're doing to stay competitive?
We're very fortunate that our people live where they work. So we're involved in our communities and we understand how competitive the loan market is. So we're able, we have a pricing policy, but all of our lenders are able to ask for pricing exceptions if they need to deal that, for good credit quality. Farm Credit of Virginia has always had a policy long before I got here that we don't want to get beat on rate. So we have the ability to mark those deals to what the market is when we need to. We also spend a lot of time recruiting the best people so that they can compete for loans and do the back office thing the best we can. And then, we're out there learning. We have the Knowledge Center to understand the ag industry trends. So maybe as the competition's doing something, maybe we can pick up that a little before and get there first.
So I think this is an easy one. I might be able to help y'all out on this. Got a question if folks can still come, even if branches are not fully open, still come to get a hat or a calendar. And my answer to that would be yes, give your loan officer a call or call your local branch, and we will make sure that you have a fresh and exciting Farm Credit hat or calendar as we roll those out for 2021, and we all look to turn the page on 2020 and move forward. So I think I can take that one off the question list for you guys.
That's a good answer, Katie. I told people last night, and I'll tell y'all, use my name, they'll give you a calendar and a hat.
I think we can make that happen for folks. Thanks, Brad. So last question for both of you. If you think about a new customer or someone who's new to agriculture, what is one piece of advice that each of you would have for them, either in dealing with farm credit or getting started in their agricultural enterprise?
I'll go first since I've been doing that. My biggest piece of advice would be talk to your lender and find out every way in which we could help you. Some of that is strictly financial advice. Some of that would be references to the Knowledge Center and the great resources and the education that's available there. But some of that is just knowledge of your community. An example would be somebody's ready to build a barn or a chicken house. Well, we know people that do that. We have experience with that. We can send you to somebody that our other customers are pleased with, and we might be able to tell you that other people have been displeased with somebody else. So the more you communicate with your lenders, the better experience we can give you with your loan, but also just their agricultural knowledge can be a great benefit to people starting out.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that. One of the pieces that Brad brought up was the Knowledge Center. We have a wealth of knowledge within our Knowledge Center, and it's a great resource for all of our customers. No matter what sector of farming that you're in, there is a piece on there for you to educate yourself about. There's financials for everyone. There's webinars, there's management institutes, there's young beginning small farmers. Our Knowledge Center has a wealth of knowledge, a wealth of resources for you to reach into, to tap into. So check us out on the website and look into the Knowledge Center. That's a great resource for any farmer, young, beginning, or small, and get to know your loan officer, as Brad said.
Thank you both. I know that is important advice for folks who are getting ready to enter into agriculture or their relationship with Farm Credit. So in closing, any last comments that either of you would like to share before we wrap it up?
Yeah, I just want to thank everybody for choosing to do business with Farm Credit Virginia's. I know there are other lenders out there, so we appreciate your business. And I appreciate your interest in your association and tuning in to listen to me. So thanks a lot. My offices in Stanton, I'm available to help. My email is out there. If you call the office and ask for me, I'm working from home a good bit of the time now, but if you leave me a voicemail, it will get returned.
I would also like to thank everybody for being part of the webinar today and for being a customer, a supporter of Farm Credit. We truly do have a passion for agriculture and for our customers. And so we thank you for your contribution.
Well, thank you both again for joining us today and for being willing to answer some questions and be on the hot seat. We really do appreciate it. And thanks to everyone who tuned in today for our virtual Meet the CEO event. We hope that we don't have to do too many more virtual Meet the CEO events, but if we do, we'll continue to provide those resources for you. We think connecting with you, our customers, and folks in our community is important. Please feel free to contact us. There's an email address on the screen right now, info@fcvirginias.com. You can shoot us an email and we will make sure that we get those questions answered for you. Again, thank you for joining us this afternoon and for your support of Farm Credit of the Virginias. Stay safe and stay well. Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Thank you.